And today, my brothers and sisters, we gather here at St. Mary's in Lake Forest to say goodbye to the earthly life of Will. I'm honored to be with Father Mike and Father Radley. And today is certainly a day of pain as we say goodbye to Will at such a young age. And mixed reactions, but basically sadness. Because when anybody dies, especially at a young age, we mourn and we cry, and that's okay. But we're here for one another. But we remember that we are a people of hope, that despite our sadness and our sorrow and how much we love Will, that we're going to see him again in the kingdom of heaven. That is what we hold on today, family, faith, and everlasting life with Jesus in heaven. So it's okay to cry, it's okay to be sad, lean on one another, but know we're going to see him again one day in the kingdom of heaven. And so keeping that in mind, let us pray. Listen kindly to our prayers, O Lord, as our faith in your Son, raised from the dead, is deepened. May our hope of resurrection for your departed servant Will also find new strength through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Now we ask you all to please be seated as we hear the loving and comforting words of our Lord through his sacred scriptures. And now I ask the person proclaiming the first reading to please come forward.
I'm so sorry, I didn't check where I'm supposed to go before I did this. Perfect, okay. A reading from the book of Isaiah. Do you not know or have you not heard? The Lord is the eternal God, creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint nor grow weary, and his knowledge is beyond scrutiny. He gives strength to the fainting, for the weak he makes vigor abound. Though young men faint and grow weary, and youth stagger and fall, they that hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar as with eagle's wings. They will run and not grow weary, walk and not grow faint. The word of the Lord.
Shelter me, O Lord, hide me in the shadow. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord always. I shall say it again, rejoice. Your kindness should be known to all. The Lord is near. Have no anxiety at all, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, family, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
May the Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled and said, Where have you laid him? They said to him, Sir, come and see. And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, See how much he loved him? But some of them said, Could not the one who opened the eyes of that blind man have done something so that this man would not have died? So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said, Take away the stone. Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, Lord, by now there will be a stench. He has been dead for 4 days. And Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus raised his eyes and said, Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me, but because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he said this, he cried out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to the crowd, Untie him and let him go free. Now many of the Jews who had come to Mary and had seen what he had done began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord. Once again, my brothers and sisters, and Tom, Colette, Emily, Elizabeth, Catherine, my heart truly goes out for all of you today, and the hearts of all your wonderful family and friends are with you today, and that shows how much you, and especially how much Will, is loved by many, many people. And so I know it's a day of deep hurt and sadness, but the Lord is with you, and there is much love in this church. A lot of people here today are praying for you also. So, once again, we celebrate love today, resurrection, but I am not dispelling the pain and the sadness in your heart today. You know, when we look at the Gospels of our Lord Jesus Christ, we get a very good picture of who Jesus is. And I think one of the conclusions that we can make is that Jesus was basically a man of action. You know, when we look at the life of Jesus, whenever he was faced with a situation, he would respond in word or deed. For instance, if somebody came up to our Lord Jesus Christ and said, "Lord, I'm hungry," he would feed them either in a normal way or in multiply loaves and fishes or turn water into wine. If somebody came up to our Lord and they said, "Lord, I am a leper. I am blind, I am lame," he would lay his healing hands upon them and cure them. If they thirsted for knowledge, he'd teach them. If they were in need of love and forgiveness, he would love and forgive them. So I think it's safe to say that whenever Jesus is faced with a situation, he responds either with an action or words. But it's a little different in the gospel I just read today. In today's gospel, we see Jesus entering the town where Martha, Mary, and Lazarus live. And when Jesus gets to the town, Lazarus is dead. Lazarus is dead. And then Jesus says, "Take me to the tomb." And they bring Jesus to the tomb of Lazarus. And what does Jesus do at the tomb of Lazarus? He just simply cries. As the gospels say to us, Jesus wept. And we don't see Jesus crying in the Gospels too often. A little bit in the agony of the garden before he dies on the cross. But today, at the tomb of Lazarus, he cries. And as I said, that's very unusual. But it makes sense that Jesus cried at the tomb of Lazarus. He was good friends with Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. Lazarus is one who embraced the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, lived a good life. Jesus and Lazarus were friends. And so when Jesus first laid his eyes on that tomb of Lazarus, he had no words of wisdom. There were no words of comfort at first. There was no action. All he could do was cry. And I know over the past week or so, many of you have cried, especially the family, over the death of Will. At times, you've probably searched, and many people have said, "What can I say to make this feel better? What can I do?" Some people, "Can I bake something? What can I do? You know, with some action or whatever?" And there's no words that can take the pain away and the hurt away. And a lot of times, you found yourself just crying. And just as Jesus's tears made sense when he laid his eyes on the tomb of Lazarus, your tears also make sense for Will, because he was a young man, and in his own way, he shared his love with family, friends, many people, and he walked with our Lord Jesus Christ on this earth. So it makes sense that you cry. You know, as we look at the life of Will, we see he was a good man, a good young man. He was a good son to Tom and Colette, a wonderful brother to Emily, Elizabeth, and Catherine, a good relative, a good friend, a good grandson, cousin. He was a man who truly loved people. And he was a gifted man, you know, and as the family told me, and as it was in the obituary, he had many gifts. He graduated from Lake Forest High School in 2018 and always used the gift of knowledge and intelligence our Lord gave him. He had a rigorous class load schedule, taking many AP classes. And he always balanced that with his love of sports. Was a good pitcher at Lake Forest High School, I do reckon. He was on the varsity team there with the scout baseball team. And he actually helped coach youth baseball programs. Once again, taking his gifts, sharing them, being Christ-like. And he loved sports in general. A natural athlete, a gifted athlete. You know, besides baseball, he loved playing his basketball, golf, and tennis. He enjoyed running, keeping in shape, and he liked to watch sports, too. And I guess he was a Bull fan. He enjoyed watching his Chicago Bulls. And we know he's immediately going to go to heaven because he was a White Sox fan. I know I'm on the north side, but don't pelt me with anything on that one. And once again, he continued his education at the University of Dayton, good Catholic school, graduating in 2023, played his intramural sports there, was part of Phi Sigma Kappa fraternity. Once again, using his gifts, knowledge, graduating. He loved music, many different kinds of music, attended concerts with loved ones, and he had a lifelong friendship with many people. Even though he was a young man, he had many friends and was loved by many people. That's because he was loyal, gentle, kind, empathetic, compassionate. And like I said, he always believed in family. He loved them dearly, and he knew he was loved by his folks, his sisters. He knew that. And he truly shared his life and talents with others, his gifts with others. He was not a selfish man. Now, we know he had his struggles in life, and we all do, and he had his struggles in life, and unfortunately, he could not overcome them. But he did fight the good fight. He did fight, and he lived in the spirit of Jesus because he was a man of faith. You know, I think Colette told me the other day that, you know, he turned to prayer towards the end. I think he went to went with confession with his dad, Tom, and all of a sudden he was praying the rosary, the one he had received at confirmation. So, you know, I don't know if he was a weekly communicant or whatever, but he was one with the Lord. He was close. He prayed in his own way. And so when we look at the life of Will, it makes sense that you are like Jesus and you cry, because you are missing somebody so close, a wonderful man whose life is taken at a young age. But let's go back to the gospel. Go back to the gospel and realize Jesus doesn't stand all day crying at the tomb. Eventually, he tells them, roll away the stone. And they roll away the stone. And then Jesus says, Lazarus, get up. And the dead man gets up, bound hand and foot with burial bands, his face wrapped in a cloth. And Jesus says, untie him and let him go free. And Lazarus walks and lives again. And that is what our Lord Jesus Christ says to Will today. Untie him and let him go free. Today he is free in the kingdom of heaven. Today those burial bands and all that stuff that maybe bothered him in life and troubled him so much, that is all over. Because Jesus says you are free. You are now in the kingdom of heaven. You know, we just celebrated Easter Sunday and we remember what Holy Week was all about. We remember why Jesus came on this earth to begin with. Jesus came on this earth to show us how to live, how to love, how to forgive, how to share our gifts. He died on the cross to forgive our sins, no matter how grievous they are. You know, sometimes people think some things are unforgivable. Not with Jesus. He didn't hang on the cross for 3 hours in excruciating pain because sometimes we miss our morning prayers. He died for all. He died for everybody, no matter what they did. He came on this earth for forgiveness, and then on Easter, we celebrated his victory over the cross, resurrection, opening up those gates of heaven that were closed through Adam's sin. Those gates of heaven were opened through the resurrection so that people like Will, even with his struggles, would go and walk with Jesus into a place where there is no more pain, no more suffering, no more trouble, but where there is only the eternal peace, joy, and love of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we celebrated the Holy Sacred Triduum, the Eucharist that gives us strength, the cross that forgives our sins, and the resurrection that gives us everlasting life. You know, Will walked with Jesus on this earth. He suffered with Jesus, because when Jesus knows suffering, he knows suffering. He knew Will's suffering. Will shared in Jesus' suffering, and now he shares eternal life with Jesus. Today he is one with the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, the Blessed Virgin, the community of saints. He is one with God. And that is our ultimate goal on this earth. Not at such a young age, and that hurts, but our ultimate goal in baptism is to be with Christ in the heavenly kingdom where there is no more mental disease, no more war, no more physical pain, no more struggles, no more carjackings, but where there's only the eternal peace, joy, and love of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is the resurrection and our share in the resurrection that gives us hope and meaning to our faith in life. Let's face it, if Jesus said, live a good life, share your life, endure your struggles and tribulations on this earth, and die, and that's it, what purpose would our life have? What meaning would our faith have? But we know as a people of hope that Will is with God. He is one with all the beloved in the kingdom of heaven. The struggles are over. He is with peace. He is in peace. He is in the bosom of our sacred Trinity and the Blessed Virgin. And so we say goodbye to his earthly life. And no matter how strong or profound our faith is or how deep it is, it hurts because Will's no longer here with us at a young age. You're going to miss your beloved son. You're going to miss your brother, your in-law, your grandson, your cousin, your nephew, your relative. And that emptiness is there. And as I said, it's okay to cry because no longer can you hear his voice. Touch him, be with him, see him at family gatherings and be together, embrace him. And that hurts no matter how profound our faith is. And today is definitely a goodbye. But let us remember we are a people of hope. We share in the resurrection. Today is only a temporary goodbye. We are going to see Will again. Someday we're going to be with Will and all our loved ones in that heavenly kingdom where there is only the eternal peace, joy, and love of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Now I ask a family member who's reading the prayers of the faithful, the petitions, to please come forward. And my brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and now sits at the right hand of the Father where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we now join our prayers to his. And so now to each petition, please respond with, Lord, hear our prayer.
Please respond with these petition, with Lord, hear our prayer, for the church, that it continues to grow and serve as a source of hope, love, and community to its members, and a beacon of light shining in opposition to the injustice, cruelty, hatred, and war existing in the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For William, who lived a life of selflessness and compassion for others, and was given the promise of eternal life in baptism, that he may be welcomed with love and joy into the heavenly home of the Father and may find eternal peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are struggling with mental illness, that they draw on the strength of God for resilience, hope, and relief, that they are reminded that our earthly challenges are temporary, and that they are shown comfort, compassion, and love by friends and family. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those that are sick and suffering from physical ailments, along with their caretakers, that they may find relief from their pain and be sustained by daily courage and hope from family, friends, God, and the promise of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the family and friends of William, who loved and supported him, and are gathered here today to remember and honor his beautiful spirit, especially his parents, who raised, nurtured, and loved him throughout the entirety of his life, that they continue to be a source of love and support for one another in the aftermath of this tragedy, and remember to lean on God for strength and hope during this dark hour. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our loved ones who are no longer with us on earth, but are here in spirit, especially Cecilia and Raymond Smrgalski and Catherine and Adolf Giedemann, that they continue to bask in God's everlasting eternal love in heaven and welcome William into their loving arms so that he may share in their perpetual peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom of heaven. And we ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You all can be seated.
Jesus, you are the reason that we are.
And let's pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, our good of all his holy church.
And look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant will may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we all might live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Please, Dale. And you are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And at the time he was betrayed and willingly entered into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
And therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Blaise, our Bishop, the clergy, and all your children. Remember your son, Will, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. And at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to chant. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
And Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And now let us turn towards one another and offer each other a sign of our Lord's love, comfort, and peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am worthy that you should enter into my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
If
For those receiving the Eucharist today, there will be four stations. There will be two in the middle aisle, one near the wall and one near this wall. We just invite those to come towards the middle aisle and those on the side wings to go out to the side wall, come forward. If you're of another faith tradition and will not be receiving the Eucharist, you can come forward with your hands across your heart and the minister will give you a blessing.
And let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that your servant William, for whom we have celebrated this Paschal sacrament, may pass over to a dwelling place of light and eternal peace. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. And now I invite Emily, Elizabeth, and Catherine to please come forward as they say a few words in memory of their beloved brother Will.
For those who do not know me, I'm Emily Woydott, William's oldest sister. Even though we were the farthest apart in age, there was a period growing up when I felt like my brother understood me better than anyone in my family. While I am so lucky to have two sisters that were co-maids of honor in my wedding and are my best friends, we were not always close in our hormone-fueled teenage years. In the aftermath of one of the inevitable fights we had during adolescence, usually sparked by petty disputes over borrowed clothing, I'd retreat to my room in tears. William always came in from across the hall to check in on me during these moments, giving me a comforting hug to let me know he cared before gently encouraging me to reconcile with my sisters. I was fortunate to spend quality one-on-one time with my brother over the years. Will and I played tennis often, which usually ended with him beating me, even though he'd never taken a formal lesson in his life, and it was the only sport I was somewhat decent at. Even though Will was clearly an exceptional athlete, we both bonded over our intellectual dispositions. When I was away at college, I had memorable phone conversations with him that would seamlessly transition from the state of Notre Dame football to philosophical discussions about the meaning of life and the nuances of multiverse theory. I could talk endlessly about my brother's accomplishments, of which there are many that I know my sisters will highlight better than I can, but Will was never one to place value on a checklist of achievements, which may be one of the most powerful things he taught me. In a world where wealth, social status, and professional success are viewed as the defining characteristics of a life, my brother never judged a person by their alma mater, job title, or physical appearance. He would often encourage me to keep an open mind when he'd catch me gossiping with my sisters or friends, and it was incredibly rare to hear him say a bad word about anyone, even those who may have deserved it. I continually struggle with perfectionism and self-criticism in my life, and my brother was always my biggest cheerleader, constantly challenging my self-doubt with positive affirmation. As I navigate the rest of my life, I will strive to emulate William's compassion, tolerance, patience, and unconditional love that he extended to others. Like he used to, I will remind myself to not always take everything I do so seriously, because I know now that a legacy is not defined by longevity or a series of tangible successes, but by the soul's ability to touch another in a way that can never be forgotten.
Two sisters and a younger brother. My name is Elizabeth, the middle of William's older sisters, and this has always been my response when asked how many siblings I have. The notion of a younger brother raised along three sisters, all born 5 years apart, is often met with replies along the lines of, oh, that boy must be a sweetheart, or oh, he's gonna be a heartbreaker. And all of these statements were accurate. Devotedly deemed Prince William by our mother, by whom the sun sets and rises upon, from the onset, my brother was destined to be incredibly gentle, kind, and special to all he met. William wouldn't view his traits of sensitivity or sweetness or empathy as strengths, but they were some of my favorite things about him. He wrote the most thoughtful, heartfelt cards for birthdays and holidays, and every year I prayed he would get me and our sibling Secret Santa because his lengthy handwritten Christmas cards were the best gift anyone could ever receive. As our tight-knit sibling crew grew up together, it quickly became apparent that William and I were the most similar. While Emily and Catherine are extroverted and forthcoming with their needs and wants, William and I were always more reserved and laid back and content with being the peacemakers. It was impossible to say no to his sweet face or pleading eyes, and oftentimes I'd find myself staying up far too late with him because I couldn't say no to his begging to watch one more episode of his favorite show or to hear one more song off his current favorite album. But those are the nights that I'll miss the most. There was an unsaid understanding between everyone in our family that William was the favorite sibling and child, not because he was the only boy, but largely because of his easygoing demeanor and patience that the rest of us often lacked. Like many families, we often fought, but William was never the instigator of these arguments and rarely a participant. Instead, he was often sent into one sister's bedroom to convince her to make peace with the others, and was always successful in getting us to make up by deploying compassionate words or a well-timed joke. And oh, how Will could come through with a well-timed joke. Whether it was to quote a family favorite Seinfeld line at an opportune moment, make a timely jab at Steve Stone on Twitter from his White Sox burner account, or just offer a witty remark to lighten a mood, William was one of the funniest people I've ever known, and always knew how to brighten people's days with his banter. Look at what my brother just said has been one of my most used phrases as I've shown off his sense of humor to others. I'll forever be grateful for all the laughs and inside jokes and for all the humorous content he shared with me over the years, from his favorite YouTube videos, shows, movies, funny tweets, memes, reaction gifs, of which there were many. Since William was incredibly humble and often unaware of his gifts, the honor of highlighting them now goes to us. Not only was he witty, but Will had one of the brightest intellectual minds and always excelled in math, which propelled him to getting his bachelor's degree in applied mathematical economics from the University of Dayton. It was at Dayton where he made so many friends and met his loving girlfriend, Olivia. Earning the approval of his mother and three older sisters was going to be an incredibly difficult feat for any girl vying for Willie's heart. But upon meeting Liv, we immediately adored his chosen partner. Watching Will and OR love and support one another over the last 2 years has been one of my greatest sources of happiness, and we will forever be indebted and grateful for the positive impact their relationship had on his life. Will was an incredible baseball player, and watching him pitch was such a joy for our family growing up. Highlights included my father accompanying Will to Cooperstown, the two of them always tossing the ball on our family vacations, watching Will dominate the speed pitch at Sox Park before cheering on his favorite players, biking up to Artesian Park to see him shine at Troyer or Wyszynski Field, to tagging along to his tournament in Myrtle Beach in high school and seeing his prowess as a closer for the Scouts. Will loved getting batters quaking in their boots with his slider, and he loved getting hyped up for games with his favorite songs. The only thing William may have been more passionate about than baseball and the White Sox was music, which was one of the things that brought many of us close together with him. He consistently bonded with his friends over rap artists like Pusha T, Kid Cudi, Kanye, and Kendrick Lamar. He discovered classics like Led Zeppelin, Bob Dylan, and Rolling Stones to my father's delight. And later, he began to open up his ears to alternative artists like RC Drive, Arcade Fire, and Tame Impala. No genre was off limits, and no song was safe from getting sent around to his friends and family in a fierce effort to get them to love it as much as he did. He had an incredible ear for music and a knack for finding songs that he knew others would personally resonate with. I'll miss getting sent his deep cuts and album reviews. I'll miss attending concerts with him, being in the mosh pit and squeezing his shoulders when our favorite song came on. I'll miss watching him sing his heart out at karaoke to songs like One Headlight or American Boy, and above all else, I'll miss driving around in the car with him, enjoying his perfectly curated playlist together side by side. I want to acknowledge that William's life was not easy, but I have never felt more confident than in the last week that he had so many people in his life who loved and supported him. While he couldn't always vocalize it, and a lot of the time he couldn't accept the love that he was given, I know he was grateful for his solid foundation of loving friends and family, from his parents and sisters to our incredible grandparents, aunts and uncles and cousins. I hope we can all find comfort in knowing that Will is in a better place now, at peace among the saints and stars. I always called William my angel baby brother, and he still is, except now he will forever be my guardian angel baby brother, who I can't wait to reunite with someday. William would be able to close this better than I could, so I'll take out a page of his book and leave you with one of his favorite lines from one of his favorite shows, The Sopranos. To the people I love, nothing else matters.
My name is Catherine. I'm the youngest of Will's three older sisters. I'm 2 years older than him, and our birthdays are exactly 2 weeks apart. Unfortunately, this year, my birthday just happened to be the day before he passed away, and will now always be remembered as the last day I got to spend with him. Since Will wasn't mentally in a place to write me a birthday card this year, I wanted to read the birthday text that he sent me last year, since it showcases his thoughtful and compassionate nature, and that's how I want everyone in this room to remember him. Happy birthday, Kat. Holy cow, you're 25. My little big sis grew up so fast. First of all, I hope you have a great day and work isn't too stressful. 2023 has blessed us with Friday birthdays, so take full advantage of that tonight. I hope Liz and Peter and whoever else you spend your day with make it special, just like the person you are. All right, time for some sentimental stuff. I've said it probably your last 5 birthdays, but I want to tell you how grateful I am that we've become more friends than just siblings as the years have gone on. You are someone I know I can always rely on for advice, for motivation, for a laugh, and for picking me up when I'm down. You are easily one of the biggest pillars of my support system, and you've gotten me through so much that I don't know that I can ever repay you. Not only that, but you've been someone I can always look up to. Your work ethic, your fun personality, your creativity, literally just your approach to life are all things I deeply admire. I love you so much, Kat, and I'm so proud of the person that you've grown to be and the successes you've had. It's all deserved. I'm excited to see where this next chapter of life takes you. I'm also excited to continue life as friends as we move through adulthood. I already know my kids will love Aunt Kat, so keep doing you, keep crushing life, and never change. Stay gold, Pony Boy. Love you lots.
We could stand together. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for a son, a brother, a nephew, a boyfriend, a teammate, one of God's children. And now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in our parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we will see Will again and enjoy his friendship. Although we will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of God's kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. Father Marty began this celebration of hope, recalling Will's baptism. And in our Catholic tradition, we bless items that are precious to us. And at this time, we will incense Will's urn as a sign of blessing and tribute. Father Marty and his reflections and Will's sisters let us know from their experience how Will blessed them. You may have heard the truth that a sorrow shared is a sorrow halved, and a joy shared is a joy doubled. So whatever joys that Will brought to you, those were gifts of God, and you yourself are gifts to his family, easing the pain that strikes all of us to the gut and to the heart. So Will was a talented, creative individual. Whatever way you felt blessed by God from his friendship of 2 years or 20 plus, let's hold that in faith and in gratitude from God. In the midst of this mystery of which we participate in through Jesus' death, we have hope that in the end, all shall be well through Jesus' victory, which is Will's victory and will be ours. So I invite you with me to pause in a moment of grateful prayer for the gift and the blessing that Will was and continues to be to you and to so many others. Merciful Lord, you do know the anguish of the sorrowful. You are attentive.
people with white hats and friends who cry out to you this day in their need, knowing that you will strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.